Come on. Shania Twain has reached a level of success no other artist has touched. Off-the-chart sales, record-breaking tours, every award imaginable. She seems born for the spotlight. But growing up poor in rural Canada, the tragedy Shania endured did little to prepare her for superstardom.
The fact that I continued is quite a miracle. And the fact that I actually succeeded is even a bigger miracle.
In an exclusive interview near her home in Switzerland, Shania reflects on a career that has broken every rule.
It was way too edgy for what was going on.
You'll see the breathtaking slice of the Swiss Riviera Shania calls home and hear about the family she keeps so private.
We're not sappy that way at all.
It's an entire hour of Shania as you've never seen her before on this special edition of CMT Insider.
I'm Katie Cook in Montreux, Switzerland. A ride down the road in La Tour de Paix, Shania Twain has made her home in an 18th century chateau, along with her husband Mutt Lang and their three-year-old son Asia. And in looking around this quaint village, it's easy to see why Shania fell in love with Switzerland.
Living here gives Shania everything she was looking for in a new hometown.
Really quite simple, looking for a place with four seasons. You know, I didn't want to miss Canada's snow. This just seemed like one of those places that had all of those elements.
And obviously a lot of privacy, too.
And a lot of privacy. I mean, you can find privacy anywhere, I think, if you look hard enough. This is, though, it's known for being a quiet country. So.
Any favorite places here you want to throw out props to in Switzerland, like a favorite pastry shop or clothing shop?
Well, L'Hermitage is a restaurant in Clermont, right beside Montreux. It's my favorite restaurant in the area. I like the way he makes truffles.
Surrounded by such luxury, I can't imagine ever leaving. But Shania says she does get restless.
So where do you go to relax?
It's funny because even though I travel a lot with my career, I still enjoy traveling when I have a break. I love exploring, period. And traveling is the only way you can really, really be adventurous, you know. So I would enjoy very much going to different countries and spending a certain amount of time anyway, at least just to discover new things. You know, a lot of what sparked real international travel for me was one of my first videos, The Woman in Me, I went to Egypt.
Shooting the lush video in such an unusual locale was the idea of Shania's biggest supporter, Luke Lewis, who heads Shania's record label.
I don't know where he got this idea, but he said, I think you should go to Egypt for that video.
Okay.
And I said, okay. And so we went to Cairo and we shot the video amongst the pyramids. And ever since then, I think I've had this bug to travel to interesting and, you know, mysterious places. So I think I'd like to try, check out a lot of places. I'd like to go to a lot of places that aren't safe right now. So we'll have to wait till, and hopefully eventually the rest of the world will become safe again.
Obviously, big news in the States, the war in Iraq. Mm-hmm. It's all over the news. Can you escape that here, or do you really like to keep up with world events?
Yeah, I don't really want to escape what's going on, and I watch the news enough to keep up, enough to probably stay nervous like everybody else is right now in the world. So I'm not one to just want to forget about it all. I think all of us need those moments where we can just forget about everything that's going on, but in general, both Mutt and I want to know what's happening and where we're going, you know, where our future lies, really, as far as the world is concerned.
Shania keeps her domestic life very private, and little is known about her son Asia and her reclusive husband Mutt Lang.
You've always been so cool about the fact that he doesn't want to be in the public eye and he doesn't go everywhere with you. There was one moment when you won Entertainer of the Year, and I've always wondered if just at that moment, if either you wish he was there squeezing your hand, or does he maybe wish he had been there in that moment?
I mean, it's just such an honor. I'm honored mostly because I'm here with so many talented people. I had a fantastic year and a half on the road. I missed my husband, but he understands. Thank you!
Not really, you know, we're not really sappy that way. In fact, we're not sappy that way at all. We don't really, I've always said, you know, I don't revere awards as anything, you know, in any special way. I don't have any up on my walls. I give them all to charity, or they go They get given away, and it's not that I don't appreciate them. When I win awards that are from the fans directly, it always means a lot more to me. So, and I am genuinely grateful for that.
Thank you so much. I just want to thank all you fans for participating in this. These words mean the most to me, and I'm sure to all the other artists. Thank you so much.
But yeah, you know, I call him after I win an award, and hey, you know, I got this or got that, and you know, he's always, oh, good, you know, good for you.
And I've heard you say that Christmas is a very special time for you. You like to have your family around. Obviously, you were like a mom figure for your siblings for a very long time. Does it kind of get that way around Christmas time? You're everybody's mom, take care of everybody?
Yeah. You know, I love cooking, and I like nurturing, and I like doing all that stuff. So, yeah, I enjoy having everyone together so I can do that sort of stuff. And I think, too, when you've got the type of career that I have, you look forward to doing the whole domestic thing, putting an apron on or whatever, you know. So I enjoy all that. It's kind of novel for me to get into that mode.
I want to ask you about Asia. He's 3 now, right? Mm-hmm. As his personality develops, can you tell if he's more like mommy or daddy?
Oh, you know, Mutt and I are so much alike in so many ways that it's really hard to know if a lot of those characteristics are coming from Mutt or myself. Up to now, it hasn't been so obvious that we could say, oh, that's definitely like his dad, or that's definitely like his mom. He's very quick like me. He's very quick. He responds quickly. He thinks really fast, and everything he does is fast, so that's a little bit more like me, I suppose, but I think he's just a good mix of the two of us.
Do you think he'll have a little brother or sister anytime soon?
Nope.
No?
Not in the plans.
I know you've been getting very good at French, and so is Asia, right? He's been learning it.
Yes, he speaks 2 languages. Coming from Canada, you know, we're a bilingual country, and you know, in the States, you guys have Spanish. So many people speak Spanish now.
More than ever.
And it's practically, you know, becoming bilingual over there. I think it's a great advantage to have more than one language.
Can you say, I love CMT Insider en français?
Je t'aime CMT Insider. Beaucoup.
Nice. Yay! Montreux, Switzerland sits on the shores of Lake Geneva, surrounded by the incredible Swiss and French Savoy Alps. It's no wonder that Shania and husband Mutt Lange moved here, where they're raising their son Asia. Now, Shania and I spent the afternoon at the luxurious Montreux Palace, where we talked about her very first greatest hit CD.
How does it feel to be able to completely fill up a CD with monster hits?
It feels really good. I think the timing is good. We can't even fit all the songs on. It kind of goes in succession with having a little bit more from the earlier stuff and a little bit less from the most recent stuff. And just kind of take people back a little bit and go back to the greatest hits and cover the history of all the music that I've done.
Sometimes the details of that history can get a bit confusing, even for Shania.
I want to hit some of the big milestone hits. Whose bed have your boots been under?
That whole CD, The Woman and Me, was... Wait, was that on the, which one was that on now? You've got me. Boots was on The Woman and Me, yeah.
Yes. Yeah.
The Boots was on The Woman and Me. That's very funny. I need a lesson. I need to get my greatest hits album.
Shania 101. That's a good problem to have.
It's time for a greatest hits album.
Yeah, it is.
Mutt liked all of those cheeky little song ideas. My grandmother used to have this saying about cookies and, you know, cookie crumbs in bed or something like that. I don't know, some silly saying that, you know, goes back to who knows when, but somehow anyway, I made Whose Bed Have Your Boots Been Under, basically about cheating, and it has ended up being one of the biggest songs that I've ever had. Live, it really is a fun song for everybody. Everyone just, and it's funny because even the younger kids, because we have so many kids in our audience, they could be 6 years old and they'll know every word to Whose Bed Have Your Boots Been Under. They weren't even around when the song came out. And I find that really cute, but it just goes to show the staying power of a song.
I want to talk about Any Man of Mine, first number one.
Well, Any Man of Mine was a risky song to release. At the time, a lot of people were afraid of it. It was way too edgy for what was going on. And, you know, everybody was kind of leery about releasing it, and I remember when I went on the radio tour to introduce all this new music. It was so amazing getting the reactions to that song. Some people just loved it, they just fell in love with it right away, and other people it really did scare. I mean, I don't know whether they just didn't like it or whether they thought, whoa, you know, this is This is out there. This is way too far out there. Because that song was so, it was so evident that Mutt Lange had produced that song. And it really threw a lot of people off. I call that my career song. That's the song I think that really, really broke me in a very big way. You're Still the One. Yes, that was a very big crossover record for me, internationally, actually. And that's another song, though, that was also, it didn't have a very quick start, but then grew and grew and never went away kind of thing, which is good. That's a good thing. It was a very personal song, and I was feeling at the time that we'd made it and we'd managed to get through a very difficult time in anybody's career, which is being new in the industry and actually sticking around without having a tour. That was a big controversy too, because nobody can understand, you know, why isn't she promoting her music? Can she not go out and do this live? All of this stuff. So by the time we were in the studio for, and you know, and preparing for Come On Over, I really felt like I needed to say that, you know, we're still here. We're not just like a sort of a cake mix couple.
Man, I feel like a woman. I want to ask you about the video here, because this took you, I feel, to a completely different place as a video artist. This was huge. It's like you had been a very sexy singer before then, but now you are a sex symbol.
You know, that's never my intention. I always just find any of the creative processes that we go through in music as an experiment and something, you know, time for change and just the opportunity to experiment, I think, more than anything.
You're even hands-on with the editing and everything, aren't you?
I have an edit, like an operator, and I basically call all the editing completely myself. So I would never not edit one of my own videos. I've edited every single one that I've done. No, I think it's really, really important. Because I am involved with the whole creative process, I'm involved with the look, I'm involved with the whole concept, and it just wouldn't make sense to not be there for the editing as well.
I want to ask you a little bit. You're one of those artists, I almost feel like the video is as important as the song. I know that's a big statement to make.
I think the videos are important because it represents the song visually. Whenever I see a video, that image stays with me whenever I hear the song on the radio. So whenever I'm just listening to a song that I've seen a video, you know, a visual image of, that's what I visualize. So that's what stays with you whenever you hear a song on the radio. You know, did you see the video for that?
She's clearly established herself as a leader in the world of video superstars. So, Shania's taken the next logical step into movies. For her first acting role, she plays herself in I Heart Huckabees. And she has a comedic confrontation with Jude Law's character.
Oh, it was so fun. I went in there for the day and, you know, they said, well, you know, just slap him around and get mad at him because he's basically pretty much a jerk for a lot of the movie, through the movie, you know, this businessman.
Finding the time to commit to appear in the film took some creative scheduling, with Shania in the middle of a grueling concert tour. But she melted when she got a personal letter from Jude asking her to appear in the movie.
I was really flattered by that. So I said, okay, I can do this. And I mean, I wouldn't even have hesitated anyway. I wouldn't have needed to have been written to personally or anything if I hadn't had such a tight schedule, but it was just a really busy time, so.
Did you get the bug? Maybe think some acting in the future?
No, not really.
Nah.
No, I mean, it's genuinely never been something that I've had a passion to do. And that was a fun day, but I also realize how hard it is, how much work it is.
That's a lot of work.
Yeah, and these guys are talented anyway. I mean, you know, I was able to sit back and watch these guys do some real acting, and it's not easy. You've got to have the talent. So I don't know. If I ever did it, it would be something that I would experiment with, not something that I would ever maybe take too seriously.
She regularly ranks at the top of those sexiest lists in men's magazines. But despite her famous belly button, Shania's image isn't only skin and curves. She gained attention as the girl next door who simply takes care of herself.
You always seem to stay so healthy. I think something we have in common is mostly vegetarian diet, right? Is that something you've done for a long time?
11 years for me. Yeah, I'm completely vegetarian. I was always a healthy eater. I never ate a lot of fatty things. I never ate a lot of junk food. So it didn't change me as far as weight or anything goes. It's not a diet per se, you know what I'm saying? Ever since I became a vegetarian, I just felt lighter in general, as far as just energy light. And my nails grew like crazy when I became a vegetarian. A couple months after I stopped eating meat for some reason. But there's a lot to say with calcium and stuff. Meat absorbs calcium, and so there's a lot of, you know, there's a whole science to it. I feel like I need energy. I know I need protein. If I know I'm gonna go do something that is very exerting, like working out or something that, you know, you're gonna really work up your heart rate for a long period of time, then you need to have carbs. You can't just have protein. You've gotta have carbs too. But all vegetables have protein. Between nuts, vegetables, lentils and beans, you don't need anything else. You have everything.
I notice there's a lot of veal on the menus here.
Yeah, I wouldn't know. I skip right by all that.
Yeah, I was like, what's up with that? What would be the perfect lunch or dinner for you?
Well, for me, a perfect lunch is tomato mozzarella salad, olive oil, lemon, salt and pepper, half an avocado, just right out of the shell, and half a papaya. That's the perfect lunch, in my opinion.
And you mentioned exercising. I heard somewhere that one of your favorite things to do on a tour bus is swing dance. Is this possible?
Well, I didn't get to do much of that on this tour because we didn't have any swing dancers. On the last tour, for Come On Over, we had the Leahy group. The whole family danced.
You're moving down the road?
Yeah, because, you know, once the show is over, you got to get on the bus and move on to the next town. You know, you might have a 10-hour drive. So for the first couple of hours after the show, most nights anyway, we dance. It's pretty crowded, but you can manage. Anyway, we had a lot of fun. But on this tour, the first thing I did, of course, when I got off stage was put my son to bed. So his bedtime was as soon as I got on the bus and the show was over. So it was very different.
Everything's a little different
after
now.
Our activities, yeah.
Horseback riding's a big exercise for you, isn't it? We talked to John Corbett at the Flameworthies. He was saying that you and Bo Derek do a lot of horse riding together. You've been friends with her for a while, right?
Well, you know, we did the album cover shoot for The Woman and Me, and then we did the Any Man of Mine video together, and Who's Better with Boots Than Under. So we worked together off and on over that period of time with her and her husband, John Derek, and just stayed in touch because we had horses in common. So she introduced me to the Andalusian horse, which is a Spanish horse, and then I went to Spain with her one time.
And she's very passionate about trying to save a lot of the older ones as well, right?
She loves animals in general. She's got a big heart for animals, yeah.
Do you ski, being here in the mountains?
I'm not a great skier. I didn't grow up skiing. Skiing is expensive on top of that. So as a kid, I mean, we could never afford going skiing. So I cross-country skied more than anything, so yeah. But I like getting outside and fumbling around in the snow. And you know, I'm not really that much of a beach person. I like being with my horses. I like being outdoors. I mean, the beach is outdoors, but I guess I'm not really much of a sun baby, you know.
So we're not gonna catch you in a shot in your bikini anytime soon.
No, I hope never. I hope that never happens.
Who are some of your favorite designers right now?
I'm not a real fashion slave, so I don't keep up on what's going on very well. I've always liked Dolce & Gabbana. They've, year after year, always have things that I like. I'm attracted to their things. Gucci, they've always got great shoes and sunglasses. You know, if we're gonna get you good, that is one of the videos where the clothing and the look was kind of designed by Mark Bauer. And he had done many things. You know, he had done That Don't Impress Me Much and a bunch of things, you know, Man, I Feel Like a Woman. And he's just really good at creating a whole look, a whole image.
Have you ever counted how many pairs of shoes you have?
No, because I give them away frequently. I don't keep anything if I haven't worn it in a while, I give it away.
I'll give you my address when we're done with this.
So I'm not a collector, so you know, I only have as many shoes as I need.
Now, doing a greatest hits, obviously you reflect back on your career. You always look fabulous, but has there ever been a certain video or certain photos you're like, oh, I don't care if they ever see that again?
Videos, no. I kind of accept. One time I saw an interview by Madonna and they were going back to her, you know, like a Virgin Days and stuff, and that was such a whole look, you know? She was cringing, you know, and just saying basically something to the effect of, you know, how she wished she didn't have to see them again. But in the end, was just I think, very mature about it and said, you know, we all go through these stages and we just have to laugh about it and accept it. So from, I kind of thought, yeah, you know, that happens to all of us. You look back at your Christmas pictures from when you were 6 years old and go, oh, I was missing a few teeth. So, you know, you just, it's part of life, whether it's a personal photo or career photos, so you, and you just have to go with it. That's what you were doing at the time, and you have to have a laugh about it, so.
Shania's music and image has struck a chord with gay audiences, and she's making her second appearance in the gay and lesbian news magazine, The Advocate.
You're kind of becoming one of those icons for the gay community, like Dolly or Cher. How does that feel?
It's cool. I like it. I've always been known, I think, for having a very diverse audience. And I'm proud of that. You know, I like the fact that I do have such a diverse group of fans. Yeah, so it's great.
Your lyrics are so accessible, everybody can really connect with them. But I kind of want to see now how you connect to your own lyrics. Let's start with Don't Be Stupid. Let's talk about jealousy. Do you find yourself to be a jealous person?
No, not particularly. Neither Mutt or I are particularly jealous. And don't be stupid, it's something I would say on a daily basis, you know, about don't be silly or don't be stupid, you know, about whatever, you know, that's nonsense. So it was a, you know, a phrase I would say, and I thought really does apply to trying to tell somebody, don't be stupid. Yeah. Get over it. Don't be jealous.
That don't impress me much. You mentioned Brad Pitt in this song. Mm-hmm. I'm assuming you've met Brad Pitt. Has he ever commented on it?
No, I've never met him. Oh, he's just so beautiful.
Oh, he's so cute.
Isn't he? He's so good looking.
Do you have any other like movie star crushes?
Ashton Kutcher.
He is so cute. Have you met him?
I did meet him. He was just as cute in person.
He's tall, right?
Nice too. Not that tall. Good height, a nice height. Have you met Brad Pitt? Is he short?
Oh no, I don't think I could speak.
I think I'm over that now. I think at one point I probably would have been, but I don't know. You're never over it. I don't know. You know, I'm not really that googly anyway.
Yeah.
But I think those are the two best looking men.
What do you think about Ashton Kutcher and Demi Moore, the age difference?
I think it's great.
Fabulous.
I think they make a great couple. They're both beautiful and they both seem down to earth. Yeah.
No one needs to know. How good are you at keeping a secret?
I'm pretty good at that. I'm pretty loyal. If somebody tells me something, I'll keep it to myself. Yeah.
I'm out of here. I love the end of this because you got like your feet stomping and the door slams. What would get you mad enough to do something like that?
Well, I'm not very, you know, in relationships, I'm not very tolerant with certain things.
Like what?
Well, if I had a boyfriend who cheated, for instance, that would be that. That would be the end of that. Any disrespect, forget it. Definitely not. I don't tolerate anything like that. you know, complete mutual respect. I'm very, very liberated in that, sense as far as from a female point of view, I would say that when it comes to relationships, I'm pretty serious about what I tolerate and what I don't.
What about I'm gonna get you good? Now, of course, this woman in this song is very driven, very focused on getting her man. Well, you got the man of your dreams, I know that, but let's talk a little bit more career-wise. Is there anything you still really wanna get, something you've got your eyes on, a goal?
Musically, you know, I don't have a big picture goal. I never did, to be honest with you. They just come as they come. I mean, it's always been a dream of mine to have other people record my music, so.
I wanted to ask you about that. You're such a great writer. Do you see yourself at a point where you may just start pitching a lot of songs?
I will. I will do that, yeah. I mean, I would have started doing that a long time ago, but everybody around me says, no, you can't do that.
Yeah.
You gotta record this stuff. You can't just give it away. So I think that I have to say I long for that. Mm-hmm. I long for being able to listen to other people record, you know, singing my music, performing my music. So that's a bit of a dream of mine, and yeah, it's a goal. I'd like to be able to manage that at some point, if everybody allows me to. If anybody allows me to.
Sporting a flirty attitude and some of her sexiest lyrics, Party for Two teams Shania with newcomer Billy Currington.
Party for Two, this is so fun. How did you pick Billy?
Well, Luke Lewis is always letting us hear his new artists, and he said, you've got to hear Billy Currington.
After listening to Billy's CD, Shania gave him a call.
It's like, hello? I was like, is this Billy? It's like, yeah, and she goes, this is Shania. And I'm like,
hey, Billy.
Yeah?
I'm having a party. Wanna come?
Of course, I said yes. I'd love to. And all I could think about is I'm fixing to sing my heart out. And I did. I gave it all I had.
He's got the southern sexiness to the sound of his voice. And of course, you know, it's a relationship between two people flirting with each other. So it just really suited it. He's got a very sexy voice, very low and rich.
Yeah. There's that line in there, something about, gosh, looking good in your socks or something.
You'll
like
be sexy in your socks.
Are you implying he's only wearing his socks?
Of course. Of course I am.
I'm thinking
that doesn't happen
that.
In the video, don't worry.
Well, let's talk about the video, because you get kind of crazy in this, right? Like swinging from chandeliers and stuff.
Yeah, we did. We had a lot of fun. It was a very long shoot. We shot for 2 days in London, and we shot the second day until 5 o'clock in the morning, and Billy was such a good sport. We were just all over the city doing various things, and the whole idea was, you know, that I called him up and invited him to this party. And, you know, initially he's not really interested, or till I tell him that it's just going to be him and I. So then he changes his mind and decides to come. By the time we get to the party, of course, it's only the two of us, and it's nighttime, and it's outside, this party in the park. We get really crazy and, you know, break dishes, and we have a great time and swing from a chandelier.
I remember one time we got swinging so hard and so high, and I think it scared her, and I remember saying, it's okay, baby. Don't you worry, I got you.
Another new song on the album, Don't. I heard this for the first time last night. Not ashamed to say, I actually got very choked up listening
good.
To the lyric.
I'm glad to hear it.
What inspired you to write this?
Well, Mutt had this title, Don't, for a long, long time. And we toyed around with it a lot. It's a negative, don't is such a negative thing. And I like to write about positive things. And so we said, okay, how can we make this positive? So we toiled over that for a long time and ended up with basically, don't give up on us. The way Mutt describes it is, you know, you want to be driving in your car after having an argument with the person that you love, whether it was that morning or the month before or whatever, whether it's with your mother, whoever the relationship might be with. This song comes on the radio and you realize, wow, I think I've messed something up. I've got to call this person and say sorry and try to turn them around and get them to forgive me, and we got to work this out, you know. And so we wanted it to prompt that.
I ain't no quitter. Straight up country. Love yeah. this one. This seems yeah. like one that would have written itself kind of fast too, like just fun.
It did. It was really fun to write this one. I had this idea about writing about a guy who had all these terrible habits, but wasn't going to change for her. And you know, he's not a quitter. He's not quitting smoke. He's not quitting drink. He's not quitting anything. But she's not giving up on him either. So you've got these really two hard-headed people. And I wanted to make that in just a very positive, you know, can-do song, The Impossible.
Achieving the impossible is something Shania has done over and over in her life. She endured poverty as a child, survived the tragic death of her parents when she was 21, and now she's an international star. It's a compelling story that movie producers couldn't resist.
They're making a TV movie about your life in Canada. Is that kind of strange for you?
Yeah, it's a little odd.
Are you involved at all?
Mm-mm. No.
It must be strange to watch something like that. I mean, I hope they get the
facts
right.
They're not going to get it right. I'll tell you why. Because they don't know everything. That's why they can't get it right. They can't possibly get it right because they don't know me. They don't know me well enough. They don't really know. Like, if you're going to make this story of someone's life, you've got to really know them. And I'm too private of a person. They'll never know me. You know? I mean, I'd have to do it myself, really. And I don't know if I would ever do that. I don't know, maybe they'll have to make some of it up or just not make it quite complete, so. But maybe I'll get, I don't know. I'll be interested to watch it.
And speaking of your life, I want to ask you, I'm sure when you got into the business and started making it, the last thing you really wanted to talk about over and over again was your parents dying. But that has been such a big part of your life. Mm-hmm. And I know for me, and I would imagine for everyone else, it's very inspiring to see somebody go through something that difficult and come out so successful and so driven and so happy in their life. Do you feel like that has been a large part of what has endeared you to people?
Hey, well, I mean, when my parents first died, I wanted to quit, to be honest with you, because I didn't really see any point in going on. You know, I was sort of, in a sense, pursuing a career as a singer to please my parents, because I knew it was their dream. I had to support the kids. I needed to get a steady job. I had every reason to quit music. So the fact that I continued is quite a miracle. And the fact that I actually succeeded is even a bigger miracle. But I think just, yes, I think that through hardship, you do gain strength somehow underneath it all. And that's, if you survive it, then you end up with an incredible strength. And I guess probably that is what happened in the end.
As you get closer to 40, you seem just so confident, but is it an issue at all for you?
No, I really don't care. I don't care. I think probably I've done so much in such a concentrated period of time that age isn't going to change. You know, you have to be confident at some point in what you've achieved. And I just feel comfortable moving on to wherever it is. You know, my mother always said she was 42 when she died. She goes, I wouldn't change it for anything. So many benefits come with that. And so it's good.
Confidence, success, a career that continues to break new ground. Shania Twain has reached a point in her life where the struggle is over and life is certainly good.
We're through, and I have one little wacky question just purely for my own satisfaction.
Sure.
Ever seen a UFO over Lake Geneva?
No. Why? Are you like, don't tell me you're a UFO.
Totally.
You believe in them?
Completely. And I was just so sure. As soon as I arrived here, I was like, oh, gotta ask Shania about the UFOs over Lake Geneva.
No.
You don't sit there with a telescope at night up on the hill? And...
No. I haven't seen any, though, but I will let you know.
Let me know.